Sup, you guys? I am here in the beautiful state of Maine. The main reason that I'm here is to show you guys what an amazing, beautiful, light-filled state it actually is. Maine is a very, very beautiful state. It's full of life. It's actually 90% woodlands. Like, it's got tons of trees everywhere. So that means there's tons of animals everywhere because they've got places to live. So it's a very nature-filled state. Now behind me, you can see a big, beautiful blue ocean. Now that is the Atlantic Ocean. And you may know that Maine is famous for a lot of its fishing. They catch lots of lobster. They catch lots of invertebrates like clams and mussels and all sorts of cool stuff. So hopefully we'll be able to come in contact with some of that stuff and maybe try it. It is a very beautiful summer's day and I am in the Acadia region, which is really cool because it's an island along the Maine coast. And one cool thing about this island is it's got tons of fishing options. Now the reason for that is because obviously we've got this giant ocean behind us and there are also freshwater ponds, streams, brooks, all sorts of cool stuff inland on the island. So we've got cold water fishing, we've got warm water fishing, we've got freshwater, brackish, and saltwater fishing. So there's just tons of options. So how about we get moving? Come on, you guys. So here we have a little frog. As you can see, he's very jumpy. I think this is a little American bullfrog, but I'm not for sure. He's just a real plain green little dude, but he sure loves to jump away. So I'm trying to hold him for as little time as possible so he can get back to doing what he does. But he's a real cute little dude and just chilling in the water because this is fresh water, so he likes it. And I'm assuming he's gonna be very noisy tonight. It's like a picture-perfect scene right now with the beautiful blue sky, the nice blue water, and the big pine trees with birds swooping down and to catch fish. And it's just a very peaceful little spot. But I've got just a little spinner on right now and I'm fishing very lightweight just for, I guess, whatever bites really. But the two main fish in here are the landlocked salmon and the lake trout, which the landlocked salmon actually is the state fish of Maine, so that'd be cool to catch one and show you guys. But this is one of the clearest bodies of water in all of Maine, so it's very good for fishing with reflective baits because the fish can spot it, and the water's so clean that it's a water source for people who live around this area. But had no luck yet, but I'll keep trying, and there's lots of other lakes to test out too. Lakes and ponds and rivers and brooks, and then there's the ocean, so I'm bound to catch a fish somewhere. So here I have a little sunfish. I'm not quite sure what type of sunfish he is, but he is a sunfish. And I caught it on a little Elkhair caddis that was just tied to a piece of fishing line. But he was real feisty. Here he is. He's about 3 or 4 inches long. Not enough to eat, so you're lucky. But he's got a real pretty breast. You can see right there, it's all orange. He's got this fluorescent blue stripes on his nose. But yeah, first fish in Maine, so. But now I'll put him back. Thank you, fish, for that catch. This tree kind of has pimple-like features, and when I push down, they pop. Whoa. Thank you. Okay, guys, so as you know, Maine is very famous for all the lobster that they have in this area, as well as the eating of lobster. And out here you can see there are lots of little buoys. Now, what those buoys are is just to signify that there is a lobster trap down, and it's so the fishermen can find them. But since lobstering is such a big business here in Maine, you can see there are tons of little buoys all the way out there. They just go on and on and on. But how it works is it's like a wire mesh trap that the lobster will go into, and it's kind of like a little one-way thing that they squeeze in, and then they get the bait, which is typically like torn up fish or something, so that the scent goes out and the lobster can knows it's there. And then there's a little escape door that only small lobsters can fit through, so it kind of sorts out the lobsters and narrows it down, so you don't have to look through so many lobsters once you pull them up. But once they do pull them up, they measure from the carapace on the top of the head back to where the tail starts, and then you know if it's a legal lobster or not. And then if it's a female with eggs, a lot of the time you throw them back just so you can keep the population from decreasing. But hopefully I'll be able to show you guys a true American lobster, or a Maine lobster as it's also called, later on in my adventure. But yeah, you guys, so you can just see this big rocky shore, not like anything we have in Texas. But I'm gonna keep moving. So, I've been seeing all sorts of different crab pieces lying around on the beach, and I think that is because of seagulls and all sorts of other birds have been eating the crabs up on the shore, so there's been pieces, but they've all been of this type of crab, which is like a cool little red crab. I'm not quite sure what type it is, but he's got this big old claw. This guy is still alive, but unfortunately, looks like he's had his fair share of fights in his time with other crabs and birds and stuff, because it looks like he's missing both eyes, and he's also missing all the limbs except for this one on one side of his body. So I'm gonna put him back because he might be in his last few hours unless he can regrow some limbs. But another cool little one that I found is this little girl, but the cool thing is she's got some eggs. So you can see she's got eggs sitting here on the pouch, so you can see. But she's got all these eggs. I don't know if she's the same type or not, but she isn't a green crab like some I found before. But I'm gonna put her back just so she's under as little stress as possible. But you can see, as I think I might have mentioned this in another episode, where it's kind of like the little circle shape on the bottom, whereas the guys, which this guy is a guy, has a pointy shape right there, like the Washington Monument. So this is a guy and that one's a girl. But I'm gonna put them back and see if I can't find some other interesting little crabs. Okay, you guys, so we have managed to catch another little crabby dude. But this guy is much larger, as you can see, and he's just as red, and he's got all his limbs, so good job on that. Managed to keep him, but he's got some nasty claws. You don't wanna get stuck in those. But yeah, there's quite a few of them actually running around in here, but they're very handsome crabs, good looking crabs. And if you guys would like to know, this one is a male, so this one's not gonna have any eggs with him. But I will put Mr. Krabs back so that he does not pinch me and he can get back to his life. But you can see he's so old that he even has a barnacle stuck on him. But yeah, there he is. Okay, you guys, so here's another cool little creature. You can see here's a crab back here. He's running away. We can make an aquarium with all these creatures. But here is a starfish, and he's a little mellow right now. I'm not sure why, if he's sick or what, but he is alive because he's moving around. But he's real cool. He's got five arms, and you can see he's like a mini version of the ones we had seen in California. And then here's a cool little snaily dude. I'm not quite sure what type he is, but he's got stripes. Just thought he was cool. But lots of beautiful little creatures around here, but I'm gonna keep looking and see what else I can find. high tide at the moment. So what that means is the water comes in much further than at other points of the day, because it's right on the peak where the tide's at its highest, and then it's gonna start going out. So a lot of the rocks are underwater. Like, there's a whole nother world out there that you'll be able to see once the tide goes out. But what I've got here in my hand is a tide chart. The most drastic changes in tide tend to happen when there's a full moon. And that's sometimes referred to as spring tide. It's just when the tide comes up really high and when it goes down really low, which for people who like to go clamming, that's a big help, because the clams typically sit out on the mud flats way out far, and then once there's no water, then it's easier to get to them. But I will come back and sit in this exact same spot once the tide goes out, because you'll be able to see it will go out quite a lot. Like, it says it's gonna be about 12 feet or so. So it's gonna be a big change, but you guys will be able to see that for yourselves. And that's when it's fun to go look around in the tide pools, because there's lots of creatures that are now exposed. But I'm gonna come back later, so yeah. Okay, you guys, so I have just managed to catch a pretty good sized fish right here, and this is a smallmouth bass, and you can tell because the jaws do not descend behind the eye like the largemouth bass does, and it's a very bassy looking fish. So using process of elimination, I've decided that it is a smallmouth bass indeed. It's got these stripes on the gills, which is what a smallmouth bass has, as well as some red eyes. And this fish actually wasn't said to be in this lake, but I guess I'm not complaining, because I managed to catch him. Yeah, very pretty fish. He's about 7 inches long, and he was a good little fighter for the short time that I had to pull him in. Since he was so close to shore, it wasn't much of a fight, but yeah. Okay, and now we're gonna put this guy back, and he's pretty unscathed for just being caught. And he's good to go. Okay, you guys, so it has been about 7 hours now, and you can see the tide is way farther out. So that's what, 11 feet and 2 inches, I think it is, of water looks like. So there are a lot more rocks exposed than when we were here earlier, and that's a great time to go tide pooling and see all the little creatures that live out there. But you can just see the amazing amount that it has gone down. And there are even more drastic changes if you're in like a mud flat or somewhere where it's shallow, because when it goes down 11 feet, it has to go out a lot farther in order to get rid of that water. And it's like you're in a whole different area once the tide does go out. So you guys, about 7 hours later, and the place looks completely different. Okay, you guys, so first up, I have a little fish here, which I think is called an alewife, if that's how it's pronounced. I don't know, I'm pretty sure we don't get these guys down in Texas, but it looks kind of like a carp. It resembles a carp. It's got pretty little bottom fins right there, you can see, but it's got real thick scales, just like a carp does. But yeah, so that's the first fish. Just caught him on a worm. Don't know too much about him, so I can't really tell you too much about him, other than he didn't put up much of a fight due to his small size, but he's very shiny, and now I'm going to let him go. Okay, guys, so here we have another fish, and this one should be familiar because I catch it at just about every place I go, the catfish. Now, as you may know, the catfish is a bottom feeder, and it picks along and picks up little things off the floor, so I was fishing on the bottom to get this guy, but I was actually sight fishing. Woo! because I had seen him or her in the shallows, and it was kind of hanging out in this little hole, which is like a catfish den that he or she had dug, and it looks pretty chubby, so I don't know if it's time to lay eggs for her and or if there's eggs in there already, so I'm gonna put her back as unaffected as possible. But it's about 6 inches long, and catfish have a protective slime, so it's pretty slimy. I think this might actually be a bullhead, which is a type of catfish, but it's very pretty. And as always, remember there are spikes on the dorsal fin and the two pectoral fins, so you gotta be careful. But I'm gonna put this guy back, and it was right over there in the weeds over there where there are bullfrogs, which you can currently hear. But yeah, I'm gonna go put her back real quick. Yep, I got him. Oh, shoot. Okay, let's restart. So here we have the American bullfrog. Now the American bullfrog is a very beautiful species. It is some of the largest frogs in the world. And these guys have a third eyelid. You can see it's flipped up right now, but that's so they can see underwater and so they can keep their eyes clean. That one has it halfway up. But they have some very pretty eyes too. If you look real close, they got little ear flaps so they can hear stuff. Yeah, it's a very beautiful frog. He's got webbed toes, just like me. You can see a very big foot. You can see through the sun, but that's so they can swim. And here is the big, beautiful tummy, big white tummy. And there are lots of bullfrog tadpoles sitting around in the water right now that I've seen. And these guys are very noisy at night, and during the day, I guess, too. It's okay. It's okay. Bilbo the bullfrog, and he is from Maine. Okay, bye-bye. Okay, you guys. So, as most of you probably know, Maine is very famous for its abundant seafood that you can get all over the state. Now I have two very famous pieces of seafood with me right here, which are getting quite a bit of heat, so I'm gonna move them over. But the first one, you may know, maybe not, it's a pretty ugly looking piece of seafood, but it's very tasty. It is the softshell clam. Now, the softshell clam is a crustacean that lives mainly in the mud along seashores. So when the tide goes out, that's when the softshell clam fishermen go out as well. So you can see here, this is what it looks like after it's been cooked. It's a little more pearly color before it's cooked. But this piece sticking right out right here, I'm not sure what it's called, but it's a little straw type thing that they'll shoot out and they'll have to eat stuff. So they'll have it out in the water. And I've actually found one softshell clam when I was here already, and he had that little thing out. All right, tossed him back. So you can see right here, that's what it looks like. There's a little straw thingy, and it's pretty shriveled. Obviously it'd be a bit more plump because they suck up seawater inside of them, and then to go back inside they'll spray it out and clamp up. But just pop the shell apart. And these guys have already been shucked and everything. The only thing that you need to do to eat one of these guys is pull off this outer ring right here, because this is the nasty part. And you can see, I'll just toss that in the fire. You can see the straw is now exposed, nice and ready to eat. Sometimes you do find grit in there because the clam does filter grit in and out of the little straw thingy. But when you're out in the wilderness, it doesn't really matter since you've already got dirt in your mouth from eating a number of other foods. So let's give it a try. It's delicious. I really enjoy it. It's got kind of a sea type taste. A little bit salty, but not too much. It's actually really, really good. But these guys, the way that is cooked is also referred to as steamers because obviously they were steamed in water and that's how they're cooked. You can just eat that whole thing and it's kind of rubbery, but I like the texture. It's pretty nice. That's what the shell looks like on the inside. Kind of shiny, but I really like them. They're delicious. So if you guys ever get up to Maine, I really recommend you try them. But they are found in other parts of the United States as well, so some of you might be as lucky as to have them along your coast. Now, the next one that I'm about to unwrap is very famous. You probably know about it. And it is the American lobster. Now, this is a very big, beautiful crustacean. And you can see it's got a very red color to it. Now, you're probably wondering, Alec, why is it so red? Well, when lobsters are cooked, they go from dark brown to red. And that's just something that happens in the cooking process. The shell kind of wears away with all the heat. And it turns to a very pretty red color. So you can see right here when I unwrap it, you might have heard me talking earlier about when the fishermen pull the crabs out of the ocean, they measure from the carapace, which is right here, the little crown type part, to the start of the tail. So this is a legal sized lobster. You can tell it's very large, but lobster fishing is huge around here in Maine. And I have seen probably about 200 plus lobster traps. You can see the little buoys floating. Sometimes the lobster traps will come in, but how they work is it kind of funnels the lobsters into an area where they go in to get the bait, and then they fall down into the other area so they can't climb back out. And there's a little trap door about this big that only the little guys can squeeze out through, so it kind of sorts out so it's easier for the fishermen to sort through. But I'll give you a little anatomy check on this dude. So you can see here is the lobster's face. You can see the eye and the little whisker tentacle dude. There's its big claws. And this is an American lobster, also known as the Maine lobster, where unlike the spiny lobster found down in Florida, it does have claws. So you've got to be careful when getting these guys out. I'll show you more about the claws in a little bit. But there's his little legs, and he'll help to help him eat stuff. He's got 8 legs, just like a spider along there. There's his big muscly tail. Now that's all muscle, so when the lobster is in a defensive position, what he'll do is normally this is flat out, and then he'll just swish so he's in that position and he shoots away. So he's able to watch the predator while also getting away, and that's a really good adaptation that they have so that they don't turn their back to the predator. And then if we flip him or her over, I'm not quite sure, now you can see this is where the female would hold the eggs. So they hold them real tight and they swim around and do all their normal lobster business. I'll show you real quick how to break open a lobster claw. So the claw is already pretty broken open. I'm just gonna take the meaty part. So it's already been sliced, but one really cool thing is there's a tendon right here. And when you push in the tendon, you can see it opens and closes. Opens and closes. No, opens and it goes open and then it goes closed. So you can see that's how he pinches down, and that's all muscle in there, that ton of force. So that really pinches down hard, and that's not something you want to get stuck in. And there's all these little edges, they kind of look like molars, like you find in a person's mouth. But yeah, so then you can eat all that meat out of there, as well as the tail. Now, what you can do is just get along here, the little membrane is already sliced, so all you gotta do is pick up the lobster and twist and pop it out. So you get all this meat right here. You kind of want to wash it off. Some people do eat that nasty green stuff, but I probably wouldn't, just because I remember it not being so good as a child. But then you just peel away at the layers like you do with the shrimp, and then you're good to go. You just got this giant hunk of meat that you can enjoy. But I hope you guys enjoyed this episode of cooking. Well, I guess it's not really cooking with Alec. It's more like eating with Alec. Yeah. So I'm gonna enjoy this and then get back to some adventuring. I've been to almost all the lakes in the Acadia region, and this is one that I have not been to yet, so I'm going to test my luck here and see what I might catch. There's tons of life in these lakes. It's not only fish, I've also seen tons of bullfrogs, I've seen big bullfrog tadpoles. But as I've been looking around, I can see there's tons of little schools of fish here. Not sure what type they are, if they're trout, if they're sunfish, if they're bass, whatever, but there's so many different variations that these are bound to be fish fry, meaning that there are bigger fish out in the deep waters. Now, luckily, these lakes are stocked, so that could very well be what they've been putting in here or what's been naturally born into this lake. But enough talking about all that technical stuff. I'm gonna get to some fishing, and hopefully I'll be able to present you guys with a very healthy, beautiful-looking fish. So I've managed to catch this little guy on a little hook and worm. I'm not quite sure what type he is. He looks like a carp-type fish. I'm just gonna get him some water. But he's got these really pretty red fins on all the tips, and one funny thing is he's got all these little bristles on his nose, so I will declare him a bristle-nosed carp. But yeah, just another cool fish that I managed to catch. Still not sure what type he is, but I'd like to catch his father, because that's probably a much bigger version of him. But I will name him Norton. So say goodbye to Norton, the unknown fish species. Okay, you guys, so I have been trying a weird technique of fishing for about half an hour now down in this little brook, and ironically enough, I caught a brook trout. Now, what I was doing, since I don't have my fly rod with, I just attached a little fly to the rod, a normal bait casting rod, and I was able to snag this guy. So I was just fishing in between the rocks, because this is where they sit. They sit swimming upstream, waiting for little bugs and stuff to come down, and then they strike. Now, this is a brook trout, and it is a very, very pretty fish in my opinion. But he's only about 3 or 4 inches long, but has some very colorful spots, little round nose, very cute looking fish. But these guys do get a little bit bigger, like 8 inches is like a trophy brook trout, I think. And yeah, it's a very pretty, pretty fish. But it's a very relaxing little thing to do down there. It's just fly fish, and it's not much strain when you do catch one of these guys, because as you can imagine, they don't put up much of a fight. But I'm going to release him now. And thank you, little brook trout, for helping me catch you. Well, I guess, I don't know. Yep. Okay, you guys, so I'm stoked because I just caught a very nice sized brookie here, as they're referred to, but it's a brook trout. And it was just swimming around this lake, and I caught it on the spinner it's currently attached to. And this is much larger than the one I had gotten out of the river. Now, typically, the reason why is because the ones in the river are babies, staying safe in that nice little shallow area where big predators can't get them. Then the river usually feeds out into the lake, and then these guys go there. Now, these guys are edible, but I'm not gonna eat this guy. He's gonna go back, so he's very lucky. He looks to be about maybe 10 or so inches long, but it's a very nice size for a trout because trout don't tend to get that big. Now, what you wanna do before you handle trout is wet your hands. So now that I've wetted my hand, I can touch him. And they're very slippery, so you wanna be careful. Now, trout are one of my favorite fish to catch because they're just so beautiful. Like this brook trout has so many spots, and there's the rainbow trout, and the, oh, there goes my rod, and the lake trout, and the brown trout, and the golden trout, and all sorts of cool trout. But once I get this out, then I can show you guys closer up, because it was on a treble hook. It got hooked in 2 different spots out of 3. But it's a very, very pretty trout. You can see it's got red and yellow dots all the way along. Then it's got a nice rounded nose, and it's got some pretty sharp teeth because they do eat small fish and bugs and whatnot. But yeah, he's a cold water fish, which is why I caught him in this pond, because it is a cold water pond that has a stream running into it. But I'll try and catch maybe a bigger one if I'm lucky. But yeah, thank you, trout, for that nice catch. And now he's going back. Thank you. Hi, so I am here in a luxurious bathroom. I have three key things right here. A toothbrush, I got the tongue brush, and I got the toothpaste. And in, or holding that, is a Starbucks cup that I won out of a claw machine all the way in Ohio during the big adventure, which also came with a $5 Starbucks gift card, which is still in my wallet because I don't really ever go to Starbucks. But because it takes me so long to brush my teeth, it's like a 5-minute period, I will catch back with you guys once I am finished with that. Talk to you later. The tongue brush. Now, some of you guys might not know what a tongue brush is, but I think it is one of the most important tools of the nightly routine for me. And what it does is you use these bristles to brush your tongue, and that loosens up the plaque, and then you just scrape it off. Do it about 3 times, and you don't get that nasty taste in your mouth in the morning of like morning breath and whatnot. It helps get rid of bad breath, and it also helps prevent cavities because there's so much plaque on your tongue. So I highly recommend the tongue brush for anyone who has a tongue. And now we're all good. But yeah, so now I'm ready to go off to bed, all spick and span and nice and clean. Good morning, everybody. It is a beautiful morning here in Maine, but it does happen to be one of the saddest parts of an adventure because all adventures have to come to an end. So you guys, it's time to start packing up and get heading out, but let me tell you, I sure have had a blast, and I know I say that at the end of all of my adventures, but this one was really amazing. I enjoyed everything about it. There's very nice people here, I enjoyed seeing all the animals, I enjoyed the amazing views, I enjoyed the food, not to mention the fishing. I caught an assortment of fish, as you guys probably noticed. I caught some brook trout, some smallmouth bass, some sunfish, all sorts of cool little things, even a pollock out of the ocean. Not to mention all the cool little tide pool animals like crabs and shrimp and eels and all sorts of cool little things. And then there were all the bullfrogs, but enough about that. I've got to start heading out and get ready for my next adventure, you guys. Reste sauvage. Stay wild.